I'm honored that Brother Craig put confidence in me and allowed me to come and share with you today, preach from God's Word. You have a great pastor, and I just want you to know that. I'm in a lot of churches, mostly in the state of Alabama, but I can tell you, you are blessed. You are consistently being fed the Word of God in this church, and you need to thank God for that. You also have a great staff, Brother Bill Sears and Brother Ken Brookins and all the rest of the staff. Incredible. Great team. So don't take for granted what you're blessed with, and enjoy the blessings that God's given you. I invite you to open your Bibles this morning to the book of Amos. The Old Testament prophet of Amos. I am going to be using my iPad this morning. I preached at a church one time and had my iPad out, and I went back that evening for the evening service, and somebody commented, "Wow, we thought that was so cool that you preached from an iPad." And I explained to him, I said, "Look, I'm preaching from God's Word. I'm just using the iPad, okay? So I want that understood." But at any rate, while you're turning to Amos or looking for it, as the case may be, some of you that are sitting next to deacons, you might want to lean over and show them how to find it. But just kidding. I love deacons. So, let me give you the setting for this book. About 25 years before the fall of Israel was when Amos came on the scene. The northern kingdom, you remember, Israel, was divided from the southern kingdom, Judah, after Solomon's death. And so the northern kingdom will eventually fall to the Assyrians. And this book was written by Amos, or these words were spoken by Amos and written down by him about 25 years prior to the fall of the northern kingdom of Israel. King Jeroboam II is at his private chapel in Bethel, along with his priest, his personal priest, Amaziah, and a host of others. And the period of history now is a period of great peace and prosperity for Israel. In fact, we would use the term today, they were living large. They were living in great luxury during this time. And the service is about to begin at this private chapel in Bethel when there's a commotion that gets stirred up outside. So the king and the priest and all come pouring out to see what's going on. And what they find is this farm boy, this redneck preacher by the name of Amos, who's come up from the south, from the southern kingdom of Judah, and is now preaching outside this private chapel. He is not a trained prophet, but he's acting on the call of God in his life. And he can't do anything but do what God's called him to do. He has to preach. He has to proclaim God's truths. And so he is there preaching right where God tells him to go. Now, the first two chapters of Amos, and by the way, you need to get ready. We're going to go through the whole book of Amos this morning, okay? But the first two chapters of this book speak to us concerning the condition of our culture. The condition of our culture. And what he does is he begins in verse 1 by introducing himself very briefly and telling these people that he is preaching to them what God has told him to preach. Look at verse 1. I'm reading from the New American Standard 1995 update, and I hope you can follow with whatever translation you're using. The words of Amos, who was among the sheep herders from Tekoa, which he envisioned in visions concerning Israel in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah, and in the days of Jeroboam, son of Joash, king of Israel, 2 years before the earthquake. He said, "The Lord roars from Zion." Now that same illustration, that same analogy of a roaring lion is used to speak of God over in chapter 3, verse 8. And it reminds us that as a lion roars in the jungle, when you hear that, if you're in the jungle and you hear a lion roar, you're going to perk up. You're going to listen up. You're going to pay attention. You're going to look around you because you could be in danger. And so he's saying the roaring lion is God the Father. He's speaking. You better listen carefully to what he's about to say. And then he continues, beginning in verse 3, he says, "Thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of Damascus, and for four." In verse 6, "Thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of Gaza." In verse 9, "Thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of Tyre, and for four." In verse 11, "For three transgressions of Edom, and for four." In verse 13, "For three transgressions of the son of Ammon, and for four." In chapter 2, verse 1, "For three transgressions of Moab, and for four." In verse 4, "Thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of Judah, and for four." Over and over again, he is outlining a list of sins that are characteristic of the surrounding countries around the nation of Israel. You know, we are affected by the cultures around us. When you stop and think about it, what goes on in California eventually makes its way to the southeast where we live. What goes on in China and Europe eventually impacts what goes on in the United States. Just look at the markets. We watch the markets fall in Europe, and it's not long before they fall in the United States. We watch what happens in Asia, and it's not long before it affects the United States. So the cultures around us often affect us and impact our lives. And so what Amos is doing is he's going and listing all the surrounding nations, and he's identifying the sins. Now, rather than read all this, let me just give you the four sins that he identifies that are characteristic of all these nations. One sin that he identifies here is the sin of cruelty in war. We would call that violence. Would we not agree that today we live in a violent culture worldwide? I mean, all you have to do is look at the news this past week in Aurora, Colorado, at what happened with in the movie theater with dozens of people being killed and others being injured. It's a violent culture in which we live. The movies that are produced are violence-centered. We see violence on every hand between wars and shootings and everything else that's going on around us. We live in a very violent culture. The second sin that he identifies among these nations is that of slavery or the slave trade. Now, there are a lot of people who think that slavery was done away with in America back in the mid-1800s, when we fought the war between the states, the Civil War. But the fact is that slavery is still going on today. In fact, I have the electronic edition of the Birmingham News that I read when I'm away from town. And I was reading this morning, there was an article that in the editorial page that dealt with the sex trade that is very prevalent and very taking a great hold in Alabama even. We typically think of it as being over in other parts of the world and so forth, but folks, it's going on right under our noses. And I dare say you're struggling with the same issue here in Florida as we are in Alabama. So slavery is still an issue. And then the third sin he identifies among these nations is that of greed. Greed's been in the news a lot lately since the collapse of the economic markets back in 2008. We've talked about how the greedy Wall Street bankers have been taking us for a ride. The fact is, we've got government officials that are greedy, too. The government's been taking us for a ride. The government's been very involved in what's been going on with that greed on Wall Street because of the laws that they've passed and rules that they've enforced. And then the fourth sin he identifies is specifically related to Judah, the southern kingdom, in chapter 2. He talks about them rejecting the law of God. And again, can we not see how we have rejected the law of God here in America today? I mean, we, back in the mid-20th century, began to ostracize God from our culture. We took Him out of the schools. We took Him out of the government facilities. We took Him out of everything else. Today, we're trying to take Him out of the military. We're taking Him out of every aspect of government. And the fact is that, yesterday, again, my wife and I were watching Mike Huckabee last night on Fox News Channel, and Governor Huckabee commented on the fact that we've taken God out of our culture. Why are we surprised by the violence and the greed and all the other things that are going on around us? It's a result of taking God out of our culture. Well, you can imagine that as Amos is identifying all of the sins of these surrounding nations, that Amaziah the priest and Jeroboam the second, the king, are all probably standing there going, "Amen, preach on, brother, let them have it." But then in chapter 2, verse 6, Amos turns his attention to the nation of Israel itself. He says in verse 6, "For three transgressions of Israel and for four, I will not revoke its punishment." And then he begins to identify the sins that characterize the nation of Israel. Some of the same sins, but there are some other sins as well. And if you go through these, and again, we're not going to read all these verses, but he condemns Israel for bribery, for greed, for adultery, for sexual immorality. In fact, in verse 7, he's in the middle of that verse, he said, "And a man and his father resort to the same girl in order to profane my holy name." I mean, how much more perverted do you get than that? He goes on to talk about selfishness, ingratitude, drunkards in verse 8, on garments taken as pledges, they stretch out beside every altar, and in the house of their God, they drink the wine of those who have been fined. On down, he says that in verse 12, you made the Nazarites who took a vow not to drink alcoholic beverages, you've pushed them and forced them to drink what I've commanded them not to. So alcohol, drunkenness, rejecting God's revelation, just like the nation of Judah, they rejected the revelation of God. And in verse 9, he points out something very interesting. He said, yet it was I who destroyed the Amorite. In the bottom of verse 9, I even destroyed his fruit above and his root below. Verse 10, it was I who brought you up from the land of Egypt, and I led you in the wilderness 40 years. Verse 11, then I raised up some of your sons to be prophets and some of your young men to be Nazarites. Is this not so, O sons of Israel, declares the Lord? Look, I poured out my blessings on your nation. My presence was with you. I made sure that you had leaders in place, the spiritual leaders, godly leaders that would guide you and direct you toward me. I gave you my word, but in spite of my blessings, in spite of my grace and my mercy, you have rejected me. We could say the same about America, could we not? God's poured out His blessings. God bless America. We've been singing it for years, and we want to believe that God's blessing, and He truly has. When you look at all that we have, how much God has blessed us, and yet what have we done? We've acted selfishly. We've rejected His law. We've rejected His person. We've rejected God Himself. So we stand as guilty as the people of Israel in Amos's day. Well, that brings us to chapter 3. And in chapter 3, we find, in the first two chapters, we find the condition of our hearts described. Our culture described. Beginning in chapter 3, going through chapter 6, we find the condition of our hearts described. See, he begins to narrow it down from the culture. It's real easy for us to identify the sins of the culture. A lot of times we don't want to see the sins in our own hearts and lives. And so he begins to narrow down and focus on individual sins, individual attitudes and actions. And he preaches a series of three sermons. You thought you were coming this morning to hear one sermon. You're going to hear Amos's three sermons and mine. So you're going to get four this morning. But he preaches a series of sermons in which he identifies in each sermon one condition of the heart that characterized the people of Israel, and I believe characterizes the condition of our hearts, many of us today. In each of these chapters, chapter 3, he starts off, hear this word. In chapter 4, he begins, hear this word. In chapter 5, he begins, hear this word. And in each one of these, he identifies a different condition of the heart, sinful condition of the heart. In the first sermon, he starts off, hear this word, which the Lord has spoken against you, sons of Israel, against the entire family which he brought up from the land of Egypt. And then he says, you only have I chosen among all the families of the earth. Therefore, I will punish you for all your iniquities. The first condition he describes is that of pride. The prideful condition of their hearts, the arrogance, the self-centeredness. And he's describing here the fact that they've been given great privilege. They were chosen as God's people. And instead of going, wow, I'm humbled by that, they go, oh, well, I'm God's chosen people. Oh, I'm special. I'm somebody significant. I'm somebody important. And they begin to boast about the fact that they're God's chosen people. But what he reminds them of in these verses is that where there is privilege, there is great responsibility. Where there is privilege, there's great responsibility. In verses 3 through 7, he argues from the standpoint of cause and effect. Do two men walk together unless they've made an appointment? Does a lion roar in the forest when he has no prey? Verse 5, does a bird fall into a trap on the ground when there is no bait in it? And he goes on with this list of analogies describing cause and effect. And what he's saying is, because you are my chosen people, you are being held to a higher standard. Now, folks, today we're not the chosen people of Israel, but God chose us as His bride, the church. And you can rest assured that if He's going to judge those outside the walls of the church, He's going to judge those of us inside the walls of the church. How do we look? Are we boastful? Are we lifting ourselves up? Are we arrogant? Are we judgmental of people that aren't just like us? Are we showing the love, the genuine love of Christ to everyone around us, no matter what the color of their skin or the educational background or their socioeconomic status or whatever? He goes on in verse 10 of chapter 3, and he makes a statement that is very significant. He said, "But they do not know how to do what is right." Now, you notice what he didn't say. He didn't say they don't know what is right. He said they don't know how to do what is right. That's the condition of all of our hearts because of pride. Because of our self-centeredness, we know what's right. We know what God's Word teaches, but we don't know how to do it. And that's why we need a Savior. That's why we need somebody to rescue us from this sinful condition in which we find ourselves. That's what Paul talked about in Romans chapter 3. Paul said that no one is righteous. In chapter 3, verse 9, he said, "What then? Are we Jews any better off? No, not at all. For we have already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin. As it is written, none is righteous, no, not one." And he goes on and describes the sinful condition of all our hearts. But then he says that we have now been made righteous through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. We don't know how to do what's right, but Jesus does. And when you die to self, you empty yourself of that pride and that self-centeredness, and you throw yourself on the mercy of God's court, and you say, "Lord Jesus, I am unworthy of your love, your forgiveness, but I believe you died on the cross for my sins. You rose again 3 days later. You're alive today, and I want you to come and live your life in me." All of a sudden, His Spirit comes into our hearts and helps us to know how to live the righteous life. Well, the second sinful condition of the heart that he identifies is in his second sermon, beginning in chapter 4, verse 1. Again, he starts off, "Hear this word," and he begins to talk to them about their unrepentant hearts. First, he talks about their pride. Then he talks about their lack of repentance. Look down at verse 8. He said, verse 6. He said, "But I gave you also uncleanness of teeth in all your cities and lack of bread in all your places." Verse 7, "I withheld the rain from you while there were still 3 months until harvest. Then I would send rain on one city, and on another city I would not send rain." Let me just stop right here. Back in verse 6 when he said, "I gave you also cleanness of teeth in all your cities," what's he describing there? Famine. They weren't eating. That's why they had clean teeth. And then he starts describing for them the drought conditions that he allowed them to experience while the harvest was at its peak and the crops were drying up in the fields. And then he goes on in verse 7, he said, "Then I would send rain on one city and on another city I would not send rain." In Alabama, I was reading the Birmingham News this morning, and on the front page of the business section, a big article about the drought conditions in Alabama. Y'all would like to send us some of your rain, wouldn't you? We could use it. Well, here's what he's describing. Some cities are being flooded while other cities are drying up. In verse 8, "So two or three cities would stagger to another city to drink water, but would not be satisfied." Verse 9, "I smote you with scorching wind and mildew, and the caterpillar was devouring your many gardens and vineyards, fig trees and olive trees." Verse 10, "I sent a plague among you after the manner of Egypt. I slew your young men by the sword." Verse 11, "I overthrew you as God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah." And then he ends by saying, "Prepare to meet your God, O Israel," in verse 12, the last part of verse 12. Now, what I want you to notice here is that in each of these, he makes a statement. At the end of verse 6, after talking about the famine, he says, "Yet you have not returned to me, declares the Lord." The end of verse 8, after talking about the drought and the flooding going on in various cities, he said, "Yet you have not returned to me, declares the Lord." Verse 9, "I smote you with all of these different plagues, yet you have not returned to me, declares the Lord." The end of verse 10, "Yet you have not returned to me, declares the Lord." Verse 11, "Yet you have not returned to me, declares the Lord." Now, do you notice the contrast in all these verses and what we saw back in chapter 2? In chapter 2, he's talking about the fact that I poured out my blessings on you, but you rejected me. Here he says, I send all of these disciplinary actions, both natural disasters and war and tragedy and violence and hardship and difficulty. I'm trying to get your attention, and yet you still remain unrepentant. Now again, folks, do we not see that happening in America? God pours out His blessings on us, we reject Him. So God starts allowing difficult times to come, and we still remain unrepentant. Our pride, our self-centeredness won't let us humble ourselves and fall before God on our faces in total humility and surrender. Well, in chapter 5, he identifies the third sin, chapters 5 and 6. Again, he starts off, hear this word. And in this chapter, he begins to talk about how these people were religious, but not righteous. Look down at verse 4. For thus says the Lord to the house of Israel, seek me that you may live. But do not resort to Bethel, and do not come to Gilgal, nor cross over to Beersheba. For Gilgal will certainly go into captivity, and Bethel will come to trouble. Verse 6, seek the Lord that you may live. Now what did Bethel, Gilgal, and Beersheba have in common? All three were cities of worship for the Israelites, for the northern kingdom. These were their centers for worship. That's why the king, King Jeroboam, had a private chapel at Bethel. They would go to Bethel trying to appease God, trying to appeal to God, trying to call on God. But they were going through all the religious motions. When God said, I want you to seek me. And in verse 6, he said it again, seek the Lord that you may live. Listen, folks, it's not our religious activity God wants. It's a personal relationship with each one of us. That's what he desires. A personal relationship that begins when we humble ourselves, throw ourselves at his feet, beg for his forgiveness and mercy, and we repent of our sins, which is what the Israelites were not doing. On over in the toward the end of this chapter, chapter 5, he says in verse 21, look at that verse. I reject your festivals, nor do I delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer up to me burnt offerings and your grain offerings, I will not accept them. And I will not even look at the peace offerings of your fatlings. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not even listen to the sound of your harps. He says something very interesting, verse 24. He said, but let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. What a beautiful picture of justice that comes from a heart of righteousness, not religiosity. By the way, just as a side note, I'm just going to throw this in. The Southern Poverty Law Center cooperates with the American Civil Liberties Union, the ACLU, in trying to keep religion out of our culture. They're very involved in that. They don't want churches to stand up and speak out against the evils we see in our culture. They want us to sit down and be quiet. I think it's very interesting that that verse of Scripture appears on the water fountain in front of the old Southern Poverty Law Center building in Montgomery. Right across the street, they built a new building, but their old original building has a fountain. And on that fountain is a wall, and the water's pouring over that wall, and this verse appears. Interestingly, though, the verse is not credited to Amos. It's credited to Martin Luther King Jr. What I find interesting is that they apparently didn't realize that Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. was quoting the Bible when he said this. And so they have attributed it to Martin Luther King Jr. when in reality they have a Bible verse on the water fountain of their old building, but they don't want us to have Bible verses anywhere else in our culture. I just thought I'd throw that in. Now look at verses 25 and 26. Did you present me with sacrifices and grain offerings in the wilderness for 40 years, O house of Israel? You also carried along Sikkoth, your king, and Kiyan, your images, the star of your gods, which you made for yourselves. What he's saying here is, you've worshipped me along the way, but you also worshipped these other false gods. Now, folks, that, I believe, also characterizes our lives today, many of us. We say, oh, I worship you, Jesus, and we come to church and we sing these great hymns, but then we often worship other things, athletic events, recreational activities, our jobs, our bank accounts, our houses, our automobiles, the clothes we wear. Everything becomes a focus outside the church except Jesus. And what God's Word says is that God is a jealous God who wants us to worship Him and Him alone. And we need to confess and repent of our sin of trying to worship Jesus along with everything else this world has to offer. Well, he closes out this sermon in chapter 6 by once again identifying pride as really the root of it all. He says in verse 8, the Lord of chapter 6, God has sworn by himself, the Lord God of hosts has declared, I loathe the arrogance of Jacob. On down in verse 13, you who rejoice in Lodabar and say, have we not by our own strength taken Karnaim for ourselves? See, pride's at the root of it all. Pride is at the root of unrepentance. Pride is at the root of religious activity rather than righteousness that comes through a relationship with a personal God. Well, we've looked at the condition of our culture as revealed in Amos. We've looked at the condition of our hearts as revealed in Amos. But the last principle or point that he makes here is in the closing chapters, chapters 7 through 9, where he talks about the consequences of our choices. Now, I want you to look with me beginning in verse 1. Amos is given five visions from the Lord. The first one is a vision of locusts destroying the crops. Amos prays and God stops. The second vision, he has a vision of fire destroying the land. And again, Amos prays and God stops. Then beginning in verse 7, he talks about the vision of the plumb line, where God says, I've dropped a plumb line and the people of Israel do not measure up. Judgment is coming. I'm not going to keep withholding my judgment. And then down in verse 10, at this point, Amaziah the priest has had enough of Amos's preaching. And he basically interrupts the sermon and says, this is enough. You go back to your farm boy, redneck, in the south, down in Judah, and you leave us alone up here. And again, Amos's response is, I can't do anything but preach what God told me to preach. I'm just going to keep doing what he told me to do. You do with it what you will. And then in chapter 8, he has the fourth vision in verse 1, the vision of the summer fruit. Again, he's saying Israel is ripe for judgment. He begins to enumerate, again, some of the sins of the people. They're robbing the poor of their houses in verse 4 of chapter 8. They're complaining about holy days interfering with business in verse 5. Boy, do we not see that going on today. People can't shut their businesses for one day a week because, I got to make money. And so they complain because the holy days are interfering with business. And then in verse 6, he talks about setting excessive prices that hurt the poor. And then he goes on in verse 11, and I want you to look at what he said in these verses. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine for bread or a thirst for water, but rather for hearing the words of the Lord. People will stagger from sea to sea and from the north even to the east. They will go to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, but they will not find it. Does that not characterize our world today? Not just America, but our world? People are traveling everywhere trying to find meaning and purpose in life. They're trying to find direction in life. They're trying to make sense of the chaos and the confusion in their lives. They're turning to alcohol and drugs and gambling and everything else, trying to find happiness and joy and meaning and purpose in life. They're staggering all over the place looking for it. And here we sit as believers in Jesus Christ with the Word of God in our hands, and we've got the good news that they're looking for. That's why we need to be sharing it. I think what he's really talking about here, though, is there's going to come a day when the church is going to be raptured into heaven and there won't be anybody here to tell them the good news of Jesus Christ. So we need to be taking advantage of every opportunity we can to share with folks the good news of Jesus and share with them that his judgment is coming. The fifth vision Amos has is in chapter 9, verse 1. I saw the Lord standing beside the altar. It's the vision of God at the altar. And he goes on through this and again describes the sinful conditions of the society, the culture. But in the last part of verse 8, look with me at the last part of that verse, he changes his whole demeanor. He says, nevertheless, this is God speaking through Amos, nevertheless, I will not totally destroy the house of Jacob, declares the Lord. For behold, I am commanding, and I will shake the house of Israel among all nations as grain is shaken in a sieve, but not a kernel will fall to the ground. In other words, true believers, a remnant, will be saved. And then in verse 11, in that day I will raise up the fallen booth of David and wall up its breaches. I will also raise up its ruins and rebuild it as in the days of old, that they may possess the remnant of Edom. And the nations who are called by my name, declares the Lord, who does this. Those verses are actually quoted in Acts chapter 15, beginning in verse 14 and following. God bringing people together as his bride, the church. But then beginning in verse 13, I think he's talking about another era of time. He said, "Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when the plowman will overtake the reaper and the treader of grapes him who sows seed, when the mountains will drip sweet wine and all the hills will be dissolved. Also I will restore the captivity of my people Israel, and they will rebuild the ruined cities and live in them. They will also plant vineyards and drink their wine and make gardens and eat their fruit. I will also plant them on their land, and they will not again be rooted out from their land which I have given them, says the Lord your God." He's talking about the millennial reign of Christ here. He's saying, one day, I'm going to bring all this together. One day, my people are going to be restored, those who put their faith and trust in me. Now, I've preached through the whole book of Amos. I want to pull it all together into four quick lessons that I want to give you this morning. I hope you'll jot these down. These are the four lessons we learned from Amos for our culture today. Lesson number one, we should engage our culture in a proper and compelling manner without compromising our convictions. Now, when I first wrote that down, I wrote down we should confront our culture. But you know, there are a lot of people that don't like confrontation. They're scared to death of it. So, okay, instead of using that word, which sometimes has a negative connotation to it, I'll use the word engage. We should engage our culture. Now, what I mean by that is we shouldn't sit down and be silent. The work that I do with ALCAP, Alabama Citizens Action Program, is I lobby on behalf of the churches of Alabama, the state legislature. And so I go down each year when the state legislature is in session in Montgomery, and I speak out on issues related to moral, I speak out on the moral issues, pro-life issues, gambling, alcohol, drugs, tobacco, those kinds of things that our organization has traditionally dealt with. And I remember one time last year, I don't know if y'all have this in Florida or not, we right now it's still illegal for people to brew beer at home. And the home brewers have been pushing to get a bill passed in the state legislature for the last two or three years that would allow them to brew and store a certain amount of beer in their homes. And so I get up and I speak against it in a public hearing. And I had an email from a home brewer shortly thereafter that said, "You ought to just sit down and..." Forgive my language, but shut up, basically, is what he said. You just need to sit down and shut up. We have a right to have this. You don't have a right to speak out against it. And I wrote him back, and I said, "Well, excuse me, but the last time I checked the Constitution of the United States, I have as much right to speak against it as you do for it. You come down to the state legislature, you speak on behalf of wanting homebrew and your being able to brew beer in your home. I get up and I talk about the dangers of alcohol and why it destroys families and breaks up homes and destroys lives. The alcohol content in it is dangerous and it's a drug, an addictive drug that's destructive, a destructive force in our culture. If the legislators take what you say, they'll pass the bill like you want them to do. If they listen to what I say, they'll reject passing the bill, as I hope they will do. But we both have a right to speak out. You don't have a right to tell me to sit down and be silent." And that's what we're seeing happening in America today, is we've got a culture that's trying to tell the churches of America, "You don't have a right to speak out. You don't have a right to stand up. You don't have that problem in this church. I listened to the July 4th sermon by your pastor." Buddy, he nailed it. Amen. But we should engage our culture in a proper and compelling manner without compromising our convictions. Number two, we should examine our own lives and hearts, confessing and repenting of our pride and any impurities, any sins that God may reveal to us. See, the first, engaging our culture, deals with, Amos, the first couple of chapters, the condition of their culture. We should engage our culture. But then we dealt with the condition of our hearts. Folks, Jesus put it this way. He said, "You can't remove the beam from your brother's eye till first you take the splinter out of your own eye." We need to confess and repent of the sins in our own lives. We can't expect revival in our culture until there's first revival in the hearts of God's people. We need to confess, repent, fall on our faces before a holy God, and depend totally on Him for everything we have and everything we are. And then He will make us righteous, and the overflow will influence our culture. And that brings us to the next point we learned from Amos. We should live out what we say we believe as an overflow of our relationship with the Lord and not just go through the motions of a dead and empty religion. If you come to church on Sunday and you sit there in that chair, that seat, or up here in the choir loft, and you go, oh, wow, what a great message. And then you go out and it makes no difference in the way you live your life, then nothing has happened here. Not today, not any day. You see, what makes the difference is when we leave this building, we are salt and light in our world. Wherever you go, in the community, in the state, in the nation, in the world, you're showing people what Jesus is like. And we're helping each other as believers to become more and more like Jesus. As iron sharpens iron, we're helping each other to grow in Christ-likeness. So it should be an overflow of our relationship with the Lord. And then the fourth lesson we learn, we should consider the consequences of our actions, our attitudes, and our choices in life, recognizing that God will one day hold us accountable. Folks, there is going to be a judgment day. God's going to hold us accountable. Now, for Christians, there's going to be the Bema judgment seat where we'll appear before Christ's Bema seat and we'll receive rewards for the things we've done in the name of Christ and the things we have done in the name of self or somebody else. We won't receive a crown for those things. At the end of that awards banquet, we'll all throw our crowns at the feet of Jesus because anything I do for Jesus is really Jesus doing it through me. I don't deserve the crown anyway. But those who've rejected Jesus, haven't put their trust in Him, are not followers of Christ, will appear later at Jesus' great white throne judgment where they will be condemned to an eternity separated from God forever and ever in a place called hell. The good news is nobody has to go there. Nobody has to go to hell. Nobody has to appear before the great white throne judgment of Jesus Christ. The Bible says if you will let Jesus judge the sin in your life today, you will surrender your life to Him, invite Him in to be the Lord and Master of your life, believing that He died on the cross to pay the penalty for your sins personally, and 3 days later rose from the dead, is alive today and coming again, and you invite Him to come and live His life in you, the Bible says He will make you a new creation, a new creature, a new person. And you will have the ability and you will have the confident assurance that you will spend eternity not separated from God, but living in God's presence forever, for eternity. And then you begin to grow in Christ as you allow Him to live His life through you, and you begin to share with others and you begin to witness to others the good news of what's changed your life, that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Folks, that's the point of my message this morning. Our culture is in trouble. Our individual souls are in trouble. But Jesus has made a way for us to have eternity in His presence through a personal relationship with Him. He not only tells us what is right, but He shows us how to do what is right as He lives His life in and through us. And you can have that assurance today. I want you to bow your heads in a spirit of prayer, every head bowed, every eye closed, nobody looking around. Father, we thank You that this day Jesus has offered to us eternal life. It's not something that we deserve. I don't deserve it. Nobody in this room deserves it. But Lord, You made it possible. You loved us enough that You left Your throne in glory and came down and died on a cruel cross to pay the penalty for each of our sins. But You didn't stay dead. You rose again. You're alive today. And You invite us to come and have a relationship with You. So today we pray that those who've never met Jesus will trust You and be saved. We pray, Father, that those who are believers will say, Lord, I confess, I repent of the pride, the self-centeredness in my own life. I confess to You that I've been going through the motions of a dead religion, but I haven't really been living righteously by letting You live Your life through me. Today, I want to confess and repent and renew my sense of surrender to Your Lordship in my life. We pray, Father, that those who are looking for a church family where they can grow in the Lord will come and make First Baptist Panama City their church home. Go to work serving You here in this place, growing with other believers, fellowshipping, reaching out to the lost community around them. Whatever the decision, we pray, Father, that we'll be obedient to Your call in our lives. Head still bowed, just a moment. Ministers are going to be down here across the front. We're going to invite you to come, take one of them by the hand, share the decision God's laid on your heart this morning. Whatever that decision, maybe you just want to come and kneel here at the altar. But this invitation is not for me, it's not for this church, it's an invitation for you from God Himself. Won't you respond to His call in your life? Father, we give you this time of invitation. We give you our lives, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand? Would you sing? Would you come? As God.